Welcome back, everybody, to game number two between Vega Squadron and Ninjas in Pajamas. Ninjas in Pajamas leading one game up after what was, a closer game than I expected. A closer game, that's for sure. After that Roshan fight, I really thought NiP had that one in the bag if they took Aegis and Cheese and had some buybacks up. But Vega Squadron held on pretty tight, and it goes to show the strength of this new squad that they were able to contest Ninjas in Pajamas, who I would say are definitely a Tier 1 team. They contested them for so long, despite the disadvantage that they were at. But we're going to get into game number two here where the draft is already underway, and I can welcome in my co-caster Blaze to join me once again.
Yeah, happy to be back, man. Obviously, that was a pretty intense one to start off, but Vega Squadron are going to go with a very different strat for this one here. We might be seeing a Wisp Tiny ratting it out on their own behalf, but starting off, we've got the Troll Warlord Magnus duo, so a lot of potential with Troll farming up with the Empower, and, you know, might get a chance to see Mag on Mag if no one doesn't want to pick it up.
Witch Doctor picked up by NiP. This is a very interesting opening for them. The Wisp Witch Doctor definitely leaves a lot of options out there, but I don't know. The Witch Doctor just seems a little odd. Why do you think they pick up the Witch Doctor specifically when they have the Wisp?
I think they could, kind of leave the carry flexible a little bit. Like, essentially, the symbiotic partner of Wisp could be one of, like, five different heroes. And so you kind of leave that option open. You force out two bans guaranteed from Vega Squadron, and then you still pick up something a little bit different. Wisp has a lot of heroes that he can work well with, and I feel like this is kind of something where Era is going to always have a trick up his sleeve and an answer. But one thing I will note is, just based on the fact that you're up against a Magnus, you're probably not going to want to go CK in the situation. Chaos Knight's illusions won't be nearly as powerful as they could be. So I would say Chaos Knight is automatically off the board. Tiny's going to get banned out, and this kind of brings you into that Bristleback, Juggernaut, we've seen sometimes Morphling, that kind of stuff, but it looks like we're not even going to go for that. They realize there are so many heroes in the pool, they're not going to look to ban out that carry, and they're just going to take off the axe instead.
Beastmaster and Phoenix taken out by Ninjas in Pajamas, taking away some additional team fight away from Vega Squadron. The Magnus and Phoenix obviously worked out pretty well for Ninjas in Pajamas in game one, so they don't want to give the same opportunity for Vega Squadron in game number two. Interesting that they banned away the Beastmaster, right, which would, I suppose, lock down the Magnus in the mid lane. I don't think I've ever seen Vega Squadron run a mid Beastmaster. Which is, again, like, I've never seen them run a mid Magnus either, but they are going to this game because we're going to have a Mag Batrider offlane.
Interesting. So, I mean, a lot of potential. Obviously, Mag has shown what he can do with the Batrider, and so I was curious how no one would perform on this kind of different hero, because for the most part, I've seen him run mostly, like, high damage output intelligence heroes, or maybe a TA on the mid, like those heroes that are all about finesse. And Magnus is really all about timing more so than anything else. And so it's not about winning the lane as much as making sure you do something with the farm that you do get later on.
Right. Zeus now picked up for Ninjas in Pajamas. Should be our mid or off laner. Either way, NiP are definitely keeping a lot of their cards still hidden, as they still don't show us what the Wisp hero is going to be. I can only presume a Tiny.
Yeah.
Tiny is pretty good versus Troll. I mean, you have a period of time where the Troll is actually superior because he's got BKB and you don't have the AC yet on the Tiny. But before the BKB, you have to deal with Greggy Exterior, which Troll is very poor against. And then after the AC, you've got a significant increase in armor, which allows you to be able to survive through the BKB timing of the Troll and still makes Greggy Exterior a valid threat. So either way, I'm seeing that, like, Tiny is a great pickup here. They're going to have to – it's not an easy game for sure for any sort of Wisp combination hero because they're dealing with the Magnus, Batrider, and Ancient Apparition, who are all pretty solid counters to him.
Yeah, I mean, you're going to negate a couple of different sources of healing there with the Ancient Apparition Ultimate, the AoE combo with Magnus to lock him down. Yeah, I just think that in general, I think that I would say the other way around for the Batrider. I would say the Wisp is actually a pretty good counter to Bat, considering the ability to break Lasso with the Relocate Tether. But generally speaking, yeah, I think that Magnus is going to be providing way too much to feel really, really good about offensive relocates, and they're going to have to worry about timing themselves, making sure that they played at the right time. But they do go for the Slark, the other one on my list, and the big thing here is just overcharging him to pretty much out-carry the Troll by being this anti-carry, soaking up all of his essence, stealing away his stats, and making it so that he can just man up. But it is very risky to do so against the AA. I think that was a really smart pickup from Vega. 10 seconds
remaining. Slark going to be picked up by Ninjas in Pajamas as, I mean, it was probably one of the best heroes to go up against the Troll and doesn't leave you so reliant on the Wisp combination. Slark is obviously a hero who can do just fine without the Wisp, but does like that added benefit, especially the attack speed, which allows him to rack up those stats even faster. Now, the last set of bans here from Vega and NiP is what we're waiting on. Vega Squadron still need another support. And I would kind of presume that Disruptor would be good. I mean, it's good versus Wisp always, but it's not bad versus the Slark or the Zeus either. While NiP, they still need their offlaner most likely. And I'm presuming they want to see some sort of initiator, but what's best? Is it a Clockwork here? 10 seconds
remaining. It's something to guarantee the kill, yeah. I mean, something that will allow them to get that setup in full. I mean, the Zeus is going to add in the damage. The Io and Slark are going to jump on it. They just need somebody that will say, hey, you're locked in position. This is how we're going to initiate our fights and follow through with that. So I like Clockwork for that purpose. I think it's really strong. Maybe something that has a little bit more presence in blocking out the supports farm a little bit. I don't know. They're in a weird spot here where the Ancient Apparition, they want to actually inhibit his levels early as much as possible. And unless you either play some really good wards, I mean, like you have to double up your wards on the Dire Pull Camp, or I guess you could use Rocket Flare spam to block the pull. I don't know. It's something that has to be done to negate the Ancient Apparition farm. And I think that just getting any offlaner that takes something away from the supports is going to be important. Reserve
time. Well, we'll see what they choose. I like the Vega Squadron ban away the Night Stalkers. That could have been a pickup for Yonas and Fawn, the offlane Night Stalker, as, I guess, a very aggressive hero. You do have some very static lanes from Vega Squadron. Troll Warlord doesn't move anywhere. Magnus typically wants to be able to farm up his Blink Dagger before he goes. Same goes with the Batrider. And then support-wise, you still need to see another support, but the Ancient Apparition to start out with is a very passive support in the laning phase, as you said, wants to be able to pull as much as possible, get that level 6. In fact, if anybody moves out of lane, oftentimes it's going to be the Troll who moves to do full-time jungle and frees up the lane for the Ancient Apparition. So we don't have a whole lot of movement around from Vega Squadron to start with, and the Night Stalker could have potentially abused that, being able to really press the ganking advantage, knowing that Vega Squadron wouldn't be able to respond very well. They're going to go for the last pick, Skywrath Mage. Okay, fair enough. I mean, the burst damage is pretty good versus Wisp. They also have the lockdown of the RP to guarantee that the Mystic Flare does its full amount of damage. The Batrider as well works really well with the Skywrath Mage. I can see kind of all of these. Just a generally good synergy with the Skywrath Mage and does counter out some of NiP's heroes decently.
10 seconds. Two amazing offlane pickups possibly coming out here. Broodmother and Spiritbreaker. Both pretty much completely uncountered by Vega.
Yeah. There's very little amount of AoE on the side of Vega Squadron. The supports especially are super susceptible to the Broodmother. And then the Spiritbreaker. As you said, I like Spirit Breaker generally. Would fits in along the same line of the Night Stalker, which is an early aggressive ganking offlaner that is able to put pressure out before level 6, which is kind of unique, right? The most aggressive offlaners that you get nowadays are usually like Clockwork, but Night Stalker and Spirit Breaker are two of the exceptions to being able to gank before level 6, and their physical damage and ganking potential would be quite good versus Vega Squadron's lineup.
Yeah, and just hard in general to deal with the rotations and the amount of pressure that they're putting out in the laning phase. Like that's going to be a big point of emphasis here, is delay the Ancient Apparition.
Ooh, okay.
But this is something else. And this is a pick that was kind of in the back of my mind. I talked about it, like I was kind of priming it, but I wasn't really sure if it was something that they'd be willing to run. Something that takes something away from the lane. Lich and Enigma, sacrificing their own creeps, take that experience back. They pull back the lane, and they make it so that it's very difficult for the Ancient Apparition to feel confident confident just continuously finding, you know, going off in his own and jungling. Like, he doesn't usually, as a support, you're like, oh, it's ideal, just pull camps, stack camps, do your own thing. With Enigma, you're constantly being pushed out no matter what you do because of the Eidolon sacrifice, and then as soon as he wants to start going aggressive, he micros those Eidolons offensively and annoys the hell of the troll so that supports have to contribute. So this just creates a lane that's really difficult to deal with. And then, on, of course, in the mid to late game, this year it's outstanding.
Do you think it's a wise idea? I like the idea of taking something away from the lane, as you were kind of priming that one you were talking about, and I thought you were talking about the Lich at the time, but the Enigma makes a lot more sense. I'm kind of concerned, though, running the Enigma up against the Troll, as I feel like those Eidolons in lane are just easy kills for the Troll to get. Well, hold up. We're not going to be seeing the Enigma run up against a tri-lane, because Vega Squadron seem to be wanting to run an aggro tri-lane. And I'm realizing that their aggro tri, while they are very stationary supports and stationary lanes in general, their aggro tri-lane is actually quite strong. Three ranged heroes with an Ancient Apparition Chilling Touch is practically an auto-win right there. The Skywrath Mage is able to provide a lot of nuking potential as well. Good amount of harassment. I don't know. This is a good idea from Vega Squadron, running some aggression, but NiP have read it, as it looks like they're going to be running an aggro tri-lane of their own to dodge the Vega Squadron aggression. But they're going to go for an invasion into the enemy jungle. Seal Kid's already down here. I guess they aren't going for it?
I don't think they intended to. I think they'll adjust as they need to. But in this situation, right, what they were doing was just using the tether to get the fastest ward out possible. Tether movement speed boost allows you to ward insanely fast, and it's better than even going boots on a hero. So you're able to get that ward out really quickly. You're able to get that vision and intel and block off the spawn, making it more difficult for it to be dewarded. But that's all to set up the Enigma in the offlane. Now they're going to see something a bit different, and we'll see how they respond.
Well, this could be very good for Vega. Seeing the lineup, they're going to lead with the concussive shot onto Limp. That's going to be the first target. The Witch Doctor cast does a good amount of work to slow down these heroes, but Limp is going to be still the first blood. Either way, I think NiP are lucky to be able to get away with just one death there, as that initiation was very superior to Vega. Now we see the rotation occurring. Hanskin and Seal Kid going to start heading up to the top lane, most likely. They already have the Slark up there. Unisimfon, do you go bottom lane, or do you just take over the jungle, the enemy jungle at this point?
Dire jungle would be really a good opening for him, actually. It's the safest place to be. The problem with that is that if Troll Warlord just kind of goes into Fervor at level 2, they can just start pushing the tower. They say zero people bottom, okay. Well, that's going to be tier 1 gone, and then they make their movement wherever the heck they feel like. So I feel like there's weaknesses to no matter what NiP end up do to respond to this, but right now, the Western Dire jungle is going to be what the Enigma taps into.
So I guess Seal Kid's going to be the one trying to deal with this bottom lane, any pushes that might come out. The Skywrath Mage is going to come up to the top lane to help out the Batrider up against this sort of pseudo tri-lane now, as Seal Kid's going to be kind of replaced by Unisimfon, who is already being chased away by Solo. Unisimfon not having any Eidolons up, I guess, can't really deal with that amount of pressure from the sky.
Yeah, they really didn't expect the lanes to go this way, and they're kind of just having to adjust on the fly. I think they're going to be able to stand their ground on the Slark pretty well. Era's not going to be harassed back by Arcane Bolt for another minute or so here. And, like, this pull coming in from the Skywrath, even if it connects, it doesn't really mean much. Like, the Centaur dies immediately anyways, so it's experience for the three or four heroes in range and gold for Solo. So, yeah, as it is right now, I think Era's actually going to be pretty comfortable up here with the bottle regen for this dual lane. It's just going to be the Enigma that has to make sure that he doesn't get caught out. Because you could see one TP and the Skywrath concussive connecting. Without a TP scroll, Unisimfon should fall.
Well, they're going to start cutting through these creeps. Tier 1 tower, as you kind of predicted, is going to be threatened very early on. Unisimfon still trying to farm up the enemy jungle. Limp is actually grabbing an invis rune here in the bottom lane, his CS-wise. Let's fix this deal a little bit. It's 13-0 on the Magnus, 11-0 on the Zeus, so pretty even so far. Solo may end up being in a bit of trouble here, as he takes some damage from both Unisimfon as well as Hanskin. Mag, though, coming in to help out his support. The Eidolons are still there. They're going to try and farm those up, though, and should be easy amount of gold for Mag. That's quite significant. I mean, that's like 150 gold right there, just out of the six different Eidolons.
Oh, definitely. Really good start for him. I mean, he's already up past Tranquil Boots and beyond, but bottom tower even bigger. I'm mentioning this, but they did it a different way. They used the troll to creep cut and just farm out every single way so they could just have constant creeps on the tower here. And either way it works. They bring down the tier 1 tower cleanly, and I think the Ancient Apparition will start to rotate. Naupash will just have a free lane down bottom, a tap into the jungle when he gets his lifesteal up, and just continue to do his own thing down here. And AA could be the one that actually helps out the weaker lanes.
Now, as the lane starts pushing in, at what point in time do you rotate heroes to bottom to have that farming? Right now, it's like kind of Seal Kid is kind of a placeholder hero, you know, just trying to soak up whatever experience he can get to, etc. But if the lane pushes forward and you can keep it static near your tier 2 tower, do you put the troll there to farm up? Or do you maybe think about, or sorry, the Slark there? Or do you think about keeping the Enigma there possibly? I mean, what's the best idea to really utilize the fact that the tier 1 tower is down and the lane's going to be pushed very far forward to your side of the map?
Well, I think the most important thing is what NiP can fight with three or four heroes as. Because essentially that's like a four distract from one. You'll get the opportunity to farm freely, and it's great for Era. It's actually, like you said, great for the Enigma too. But I feel like they're going to just be losing tier one after tier one if they just put like the Enigma in the jungle and a core down bottom. I feel like the having only two or three heroes actually doing things on the map would be a losing strategy for NiP. They're under a lot of pressure here. Towers are falling quickly, and that's giving Blink Daggers to Magnus and Batrider. Just kind of, by the basic fact that the team is getting a ton of gold. So it's really important that they get their fighting heroes on the front line here. Witch Doctor should be able to get involved pretty soon, but the weird thing is Seal Kid was zoned out so hard by the troll, he's only level one. Because the creeps were all dying under the tower, Witch Doctor is actually, despite, like, we were kind of seeing him kind of try to take care of the lane, he's no better off than he would be in another lane. It's really weird.
All right, well, we have another pause this time for Ninjas in Pajamas. Hanskin having some slight issues, but Ninjas in Pajamas are going to be suffering quite heavily here. Vega Squadron are taking control of the laning phase. The unfortunate part is I don't think their heroes can really keep this pressure up on NiP. As, like, again, troll, AFK farm until, like, 20, 25 minutes when he picks up S and Y, maybe 30 minutes for BKB. Then you've got the Magnus, who is going to be looking for pickoff, same goes with Batrider and Skywrath Mage, but I feel like mainly because the troll is usually a hero that wants to just kind of AFK farm until he enters into the game quite heavily by the 30-minute marker, it means that they're actually going to have some space for Ninjas in Pajamas to be able to make a comeback. And that's just one of the downsides of the Vega draft, is that they did focus so much on their mid to late game, you know, pickoff slash teamfight setup that they don't have the way to keep pressure up during that transitional phase of about 15 to 25 minutes.
Yeah, it's going to be very interesting because, I mean, obviously the lanes are breaking down pretty quickly. Soon enough, we won't be able to call this a laning phase. And even Batrider's going behind enemy towers, the tether away should be fine. But, like, so they're going to be diving. They're going to be pressuring really hard very soon. And actually, are they going to actually go for the Wisp here? It could happen, but it seems very risky.
Yeah, Era starts getting some right clicks in. Hanskin is going to get a tether away. Nice idea, but the skewer is there from no one. He already counteracts that retreat and is able to get the additional kill. They'll continue to put pressure on this tier 1 tower in top lane.
Yep, so Slark's in a really awkward position as an offlane solo right now, and it's just, I mean, as far as sustainability, he has no issues, but actually getting out to the creep wave and not feeling like he's going to die in 2 seconds is another thing entirely. So they do end up rotating the Slark down, and it's going to be the top lane that they end up abandoning, and I think that's probably the right call. Although you don't want to continue to feed more gold to Vega when the troll inevitably rotates up there and takes that tower, I think this kind of gets them back to a little bit of a state of normalcy, where essentially it's just an offlane Enigma that's jungling, and everybody else is doing the thing they normally would. So tier 1 tower is going to go down pretty quickly up top, and Batrider is going to have a crazy fast Blink Dagger. But otherwise, I think NiP are able to get their heads back around a kind of standard progression.
Yeah, and if they just stay, like, if they do continue to just abandon that top lane, even after the tier 1 tower is down, staying grouped up is the best idea against the early Blink Dagger and the Batrider, right? Trying to counter out that pickoff potential by keeping two or three heroes grouped up at all times in order to make sure you have some sort of response. So Era and the rest of his team do have an opportunity here to be able to deal with Vega's aggression. Just we'll see how successful they are at it. As Mag is going to take the enemy jungle for his own, Vega Squadron, another very smart play by him. It's going to be seen by the two supports, but not much they can do as a Witch Doctor and a Wisp. They're trying to catch up to him. They do have a cast. There's going to be thrown out eventually. Vera is not going to be in range of the pounce, and that will mean Mag should survive. No, actually, the Zeus ultimate goes out, and the right clicks are just enough. They do get the kill in the end, even if it wasn't through the pounce.
Yep, so they do nab that very important kill, lock down the Batrider, pretty much negating the gold that he got from the top tier 1, and that still kind of sets them in a position where they can start to bring this game back into what they're looking for out of this draft. I mean, Stark is going to have level 6, he could go for a Hand of Midas this game. I mean, he went for the Orb of Venom because he thought he was going to be fighting top, but instead of going treads, there is the possibility of Midas to get a kind of smoother rebound. What do you think?
I think that's not a bad idea, since you know the troll needs some farm time. Despite the fact, like, normally if you're in this position, I would say 8 or 9 times out of 10, when you're feeling like, oh god, we're going to be, I would say, 2,000, yeah, well, in fact, 3,000 gold behind during just the laning phase, you can't afford to go for a somewhat greedier, quote-unquote, option like Midas. But knowing that Vega Squadron don't have the they don't have the kind of draft that allows them to just 20 minutes in, 5-man down tier 2s and tier 3s, I think you can spend some time going for that recovery Midas on the Slark, and I think it's actually probably the best option for him in this game, seeing as they're already kind of behind and he needs some catch-up material.
Yeah. If he dies once or twice on his way there, he'll probably just go back for the treads, but right now he's got the Gloves with Haste. I think he's looking for the Midas, and since Mag isn't going to have the Blink Dagger right about now or in the next minute or two, I think that's a safe enough choice. Solo Mag is kind of a dual lane that's happening right now, though, and that's going to put more pressure on Era. Like, it just doesn't feel like there's a place where he can really find time for himself, so if he can pinch pennies and get the value out of that Midas, that's probably going to be ideal.
So 7.5 minutes in, since we are seeing a lot of towers fall, let's take a look at the net worth kind of early here. It's 4,800 for the Troll, 4K on the Magnus. The cast actually bounces back to Mag. Oh my god, twice in a row. Poor Mag takes a good amount of damage from that one. Very important for them to continue to chase the Batrider away from their jungles. The jungle is such an important source of income for Ninjas and Majamas right now. Their whole entire strategy is revolving around the jungle, essentially. Between Enigma farming it up and then the two supports kind of bouncing around, they need to be able to keep control of this bottom half of the map.
Mm-hmm. One thing that is worth noting, though, is that Limp has had a pretty standard game so far. He's moving up the ranks here. Level 8 Zeus, got his Arcane Boots, his Soul Ring, and a bottle is going to be crowed for him. So, like, he's in a position where he can still make things happen. He obviously got the assist with that Thunder God's Wrath earlier, and he's just kind of trying to do the best that he can. In this game in particular, Zeus was a really smart pick because they knew they were up against Magnus and Batrider, and those Blink Daggers getting canceled would just completely changes the scope of the fight. So I think that he's going to be able to do quite a bit, but in this position where he's doing good, but his entire team is kind of struggling, where do you think he should go?
I mean, item-wise, I think he needs some mobility, to be honest. I'm not sure if he, like, if it's possible for him to go, like, quick Blink Dagger and try and respond to the blinks for blink sort of situations. The Magnus tries to jump on you, or the Batrider tries to jump on you, you know, you blinking away, essentially. But the reason I'm going down that line of thought is my biggest issue is if Vega Squadron just full-out aggression onto Zeus constantly, where's the response? NiP won't really have that much response, primarily because their supports aren't really that functioning. You know, you've got a Wisp who is very lackluster, and any kind of single support he brings in, if he manages to pull in, say, the Slark, I don't think the Slark is going to make that much difference in that, you know, 15 to 25 minute marker. Very unlikely. The best hero that they actually have is the Enigma, and the Enigma is more about the mech early on, and probably won't be able to respond with very good black holes early. So I don't know. I think he needs some sort of survivability. I'm not sure if mobility is the best option. He goes to Yule Scepter, or maybe he just goes for the straight Bloodstone BKB and tries to tank up as much as possible. But he needs to think about survivability first, because that's always a problem for Zeus in the first place, but this game even more so than most others.
Yeah, Blink Bat coming out with the lasso available, and so hard to respond to the situation with the AA already having Ice Blast. Like, dealing with the Batrider is bad enough, but when you know that an Ice Blast is probably coming out right on top of it, it's critical. Now we see Giannis the Fan, yeah, no chance in hell. Even if he had the mech complete, it wouldn't matter.
Mag is brought a bit low there, but Zeus not quite enough nuking damage to be able to get the kill, plus he doesn't even have his ultimate up right now. So, missed opportunity there. Meanwhile, double damage on Pasha will allow him to solo up Roshan. Another big advantage for Vega Squadron. And I'm just looking at this lead just build up more and more to the favor of Vega Squadron. I'm thinking to myself, unless they seriously mess up some team fights, they should just be able to cream NiP with such an economical advantage.
Yeah, it's just they threw NiP out of their comfort zone early. They're really capitalizing on it now, and the Batrider and Magnus are really good heroes to do that. I mean, the Troll, yeah, he needs a little bit of time to farm, but with the easy double damage rune, killing off Roche freely because of all the space that's created for him, he's just, like, he's using this time so effectively. His GPM is about to approach 600 at 1120, and it's just, like, the towers add into that, the kills add into that, just in general, this is a really good game for him to be, and that's not going to be the death of the Witch Doctor, but they're putting pressure out everywhere.
Yeah, fortunately, the Skira misses, and Witch Doctor will survive with just a bit of HP, and will be able to still farm up that top lane. He's got the Witch Doctor ultimate coming up soon. Meanwhile, Yonosan Fan has his mech and just another 60 gold there. Era, well, Hanskin's level 6, so maybe they finally have some relocate plays available, but seems like most of them are going to be reactive rather than proactive. I don't see them really being able to set up too many ganks. They're going to go for bottom lane to start here, trying to get the, he has to land this pounce, but Era's already too far away. Pasha will be able to get out. Yonosan Fan is here to be able to respond, and they are running away. They have Vega Squadron. The rest of them are trying to get in range. Batrider's going to be the first to come in, grabs Yonosan Fan, pulls him in. Mystic Flare will be able to finish him off. Meanwhile, Hanskin was going to relocate out there for fear of Pasha being able to get that bash and lock down some of those heroes. I don't think they're going to be able to come back, though. This is
he's going to try to tether out and over to Era, but he'll be scared back immediately. What a good play. I mean, there were a couple ways. Flame Break also manipulating his positioning, but that was, just going to get those clean kills. And the Batrider was smoking up for that lasso, so he's still just kind of back-to-back every time he has that ultimate off cooldown, creating more dominance across the map. But I think they should probably start warding this area. I'm not sure if this sentry in the middle of the Radiant Jungle actually dewarded anything from the Dire, but they could definitely benefit from just, like, putting an entire veil of vision over top.
Bit of damage coming out. No one drops a little low, but nothing too major. Another Ice Blast. Good one, too, landing on 3. Era, well, he's actually just watching Pasha farm. There's not much he can do about that. His night vision does give him some idea of what's going on, but doesn't give him the power to change it.
So here are these observer wards I was talking about. Solo going to be moving in, maybe put one here in a position where you can kind of see the western part of the jungle. And pretty much along those lines, he's going to be able to see right over when they can find those opportunities and see Slark before he sees them, which is pretty important. But I don't know if we even got a chance to talk about it. This game's so fast-paced, but Sioma has a hand of Midas, and he's had it for a little while now, at least a minute and a half. So he's doing pretty well for himself, just farming up top, holding the tower, and Midasing away towards that Ag 16.
Tier 1 tower is going to go down soon. It seems like Vega Squadron are going to give this one up, surprisingly. They'll get the middle Tier 1 tower in exchange for it, but just seems kind of natural that they would... Oh, nice to not.
Wow.
Very well played by the Ancient Apparition.
Yeah, just giving them nothing. NIP really just cannot get off the ground and farm. The net worth is so stifled, stagnated. I mean, even Zeus, he does get his Blink Dagger, as you were talking about, but he's having to farm the enemy jungle to actually build himself back up, because the rest, anything they can actually get safely, belongs to Era.
Right. Pasha, with the Empower buff and the maxed out Fervor, Tier 2 tower is going to go down pretty quickly, and they still have the Aegis. If they want to, they can try and poke uphill and just see. Normally, you don't see a Troll Warlord really try and bank for team fights before BKB, but just sheerly because of net worth advantage, I think they could probably, maybe not force a fight uphill, but they could probably just kind of poke at that Tier 3 tower and see how NiP responds.
What do you think about Solo's build here? Triple Null Talisman.
Yeah, it's one hell of a build. I was looking at it earlier when he just had boots and double Null Tallies, and I was like, okay. I mean, that's definitely some efficient stats, that's for sure. Being able to get a high increase in intelligence. I mean, it makes a certain amount of sense, right? He has to make up for the Ancient Apparition when it comes to lack of movement, right? He's the solo moving support in this game, so he kind of has to get as much early game advantage as possible, and Null Talismans is definitely one way to do that.
Yeah, I mean, you actually do the math on it, and he's actually hitting for 230 damage per arcane bolt. So for the low HP targets he's up against, I mean, that's a lot. I mean, that's a no finger of death, but it's still a huge chunk of damage to spam out on a 2 second cooldown. And Sealgood, you're gonna eat the brunt of that as he goes down.
Zeus threatening the ultimate, but realizes there is not going to be any opportunities. Another tier 1 tower is going to be going down. I think NiP are doing a good job trying to bit by bit poke these towers down. But unfortunately, this one will be addressed by Vega Squadron as they are going to go for a 5-man push in. Pasha, recently picking up the Blink Dagger, enters into the enemy jungle to try and cut off some of the NiP heroes. But they will all manage to get out, whether through TPs or just a superior movement.
The only thing that confused me is he went Tranquil Boots too. Like, it seems like if you go triple Null Tail, you could turn those brown boots into treads. His HP is not really going to be an issue, so it really just seems like trying to get some armor is really the only reason you'd go for that item in particular. I kind of like the idea of treads, double or triple Null Tail, but adding in these Tranquils, I guess it's against the Zeus harassment since they don't get put on cooldown. But overall, it's quite confusing.
Right. Another tier 2 tower doomed to fall here as the troll ultimate goes out, and look how quickly it just collapses under the weight of the Vega Squadron assault. Two heroes going in. Blink Dagger is going to be able to catch out Yonah some fun. He doesn't have much to stop this one unless they really want to go full offense here and try and lay down a black hole. Relocate coming in from the side. RP actually locks down the Wisp. He's going to go for the skewer back. Era is going to come in from the side. They already got these heroes low, but on the side, Sealkid tried to get off the ultimate, but immediately countered by the Skywrath Mage, who's taken some damage from Limp Link forward and will be able to lock down solo. Looks like they're going to be able to get the Ancient Apparition as well, and that's the start there. Mm-hmm. They got a lot of heroes low on the side of Vega Squadron. Didn't get as many kills as they probably hoped to with the Magnus and Troll dropping so low. But it is a start of a comeback here for Ninjas in Pajamas.
Definitely. I mean, I think the Magnus just really misread that situation about the RP movement and the skewer back and stuff. None of it actually helped Vega try to take that fight. And obviously the Troll had already taken so much damage. That Malediction at 3 points in it was able to take the troll down to practically fatal range. He was very close to going down there. So really, that wasn't the time to fight. That wasn't the time to skewer them into everybody. That was just an unfortunate way to play it that actually cost them a lot. 500 gold went to both the Zeus and to the Slark. And we were talking about the impact of that tower deny, taking that gold away up top. Well, that's made up for with the fight that NIP are able to find here.
All right, 18 minutes in. It's 3-6 right now with Vega Squadron holding on to about a 8,500 gold lead. They previously were sitting about 10.5, but unfortunately after that fight, they gave up a lot of gold and even more experience to the way of Ninjas in Pajamas, who already have that Midas advantage on the Slark, and that's going to start building up as he's already caught up with the Magnus and will be setting his sights on the Troll next, though. That is going to take a long, long time. The net worth lead of the Troll sitting at 3K over the Slark right now, plus the Troll is a very proficient farmer where Slark really isn't.
Almost finding a kill on the Batrider there. They've got a lot of stuns, and obviously the Black Hole they might want to throw out, but it's going to be ultimate coming from the AA, and two Arcane Bolts is all it takes. These little doves, they may seem pitiful, but they actually do a ton of damage. And it's going to be the Enigma to fall for now. Now healing up with the Voodoo Restoration, Slark going in, and they do get the kill on the bat quite swiftly. Now no Shadowblade for a while. It looks like they'll be able to connect with the Pounce, and that is some key kills.
Yeah, Vega Squadron just playing a bit too overly aggressive, I would say, going from the free pickoff on the Enigma to trying to go for more on the Wisp and overextending themselves, beating away two kills for one. At least they are making trade-offs, though. The tier 2 tower in the top lane gets very much threatened by the Troll who pops the ultimate. Quickly blinks away, though. Doesn't want to be paying the same price that his brothers did on the side of Vega.
How valuable do you feel these tier 2 towers are at this point? Because, like, we've already seen all of these towers destroyed. There's tons of gold flooding Vega's coffers. And this last outer 2 tower doesn't really give NIP access to it. It almost seems like a liability at this point. They're like, we're already at a net worth disadvantage. I mean, yeah, they'll fight it if they are able to, but I almost don't feel like it's you listed in a trade-off when the fact that it's like a tiny bit of momentum for Vega and not much more.
Yeah, I would say like it's gold on the map that Vega will eventually pick up, right? Like they're whether you saved it right then or you save it 2 minutes from now, like it doesn't matter. Vega Squadron are gonna get that gold eventually, right? and it's going to start building into their inevitable push uphill. So I don't think the tier 2s are worth a whole lot. I would definitely trade off a tier 2 for any kill you can get on the side of Vega Squadron, seeing how far ahead they are and how much in need you are for experience as well as gold.
Yeah, and then mathematically that's usually the opposite, but in this game, like, that's just, there's really limited value, and especially to that top tier 2, and there's so much they need to make up for in terms of kills. I mean, they only have 5, so any kill they are able to build up is huge. The Zeus just finished his Bloodstone, rushed it out after the Blink Dagger, so he's going to be able to take those kills and do something else with them, and turn it into team-wide survivability. But again, that just means Siouma has more incentive to kind of just stay across the other side of the map, farm his eggs, and then eventually just kind of sit in Fountain and throw out his Ice Blast to try to hit everyone.
Mm-hmm. 13k on the troll. He now finishes up his BKB, Blink, SNY, BKB, and he can get rid of his TP scroll for an Aegis to be picked up quite soon here, as I doubt NiP. They found some good pickoffs, and they're making a minor recovery in Golden Experience, but that doesn't mean they have the strength to be able to contest Vega Squadron around the Roshan pit, unless they get some good pickoffs. Nice blink away there from Mag, though. One step ahead of the Slark.
Mm-hmm. And I think nighttime is a big factor of why NiP can move around like this. Like, if you look at their vision, they all have it all purely on the defensive. Bottom lane, for example, where the RP will come through onto the Enigma, they'll be able to combo it up nicely. Black hole is a nice idea, friend, but...
Oh, boy, they're actually gunning for this one. Relocate, Hanskin, why? I guess they thought they were going to be able to get a lot more out of that than they really did. Vega Squadron, I think they just assumed that was like kind of the troll Magnus by themselves.
Yeah, they thought that was a two-man play plus maybe Ice Blast, and they thought they could do more. But then more and more kept coming, and the Wisp probably had the Tethered, and it was like, nope, this is bad. And he just sends himself in.
All right, so Aegis going to be picked up. Oh, top. Wait. Witch Doctor gets picked off as well by Vega Squadron. Yeah. Is under attack.
At this point, your black hole's down. You're on the defensive no matter what. Slark Cold Slice some time to get the tier 2, and that's what they're looking for. Some positive momentum. We're going to see a TP away most definitely at this point. And yeah, I mean, burning the lasso, burning through RP, just anything, as long as they can buy themselves time. That's the bottom line for NiP. They're not trying to make these sacrificial plays. But the end game is just get this Slark a real item. And it looks like it's going to be a Scotty. I mean, he could disassemble for Manta, but really, Scotty is the item that he needs.
Right. Another scouting Zeus ultimate reveals the Ancient Apparition, who is farming up their own jungle. He's trying to finish off that Aghanim's upgrade, and he's pretty close to it, too. Just needs another 670 gold. He'll be there. The Enigma. Boots of Travel in some trouble right now. Malphus goes out. Pasha not popping the BKB just yet. Doesn't want to commit that 10 seconds of magic immunity for the kill on the Enigma. So they just go ahead and back off with a small amount of aggression there. Limp. What's he doing here? Oh, he reveals a ward. And that's about it for now. Boots of Travel picked up by the Enigma. I like this play, though. I mean, he's going Necronomicon. He's going Boots of Travel. He is all out on split push, and I think that's the play Jonas has to make.
Yeah, I mean, you look at this top lane. It's the exact opposite situation from what we saw from game one. Still the Radiant side, but opposite teams. And actually going to see a very interesting smoke play here. I mean, you would assume the troll is not by himself. NiP respectively have enough split push pickoff potential to make that happen, but just disguising their position might set up that blink skewer that could allow them to siege so much easier. And actually, it's going to be the mag going in, setting up the potential RP follow through, but the death ward from the high ground going to be able to do some good damage here.
Oh man, Limp just barely died there from the last little blast of the Skywrath Mage, but I would say worth it. I mean, they took down the Aegis at the very least. This gives them a fighting chance, but NiP, do they still contest? The Zeus is up in another 10 seconds. They're split pushing. One TP back, two TPs back. Yonosamfan is ready to go. He's going to stall up Pasha as best as possible. The rest of Vega Squadron sitting on the side, waiting for that critical initiation. Oh. RP manages to catch two. Pull back in. Era going to try and counter initiate. Goes straight for Mag, but unable to lock him down. Gets the pounce. Now he'll get him. Zeus ultimate gets laid down. Pasha, who pops his BKB, is not going to be able to. Oh, man. First hit maim. That could mean a lot. Ice Blast comes out. Era quickly dodges it. Nice play. Limp moving forward. They need to be able to catch more here to get the Malphus onto the Ancient Apparition, and it looks like that's the only kill that they'll get. But still, they keep their racks alive. They keep themselves in this game for just a little while longer. And Solo, well, he's got a 4 staff, so he will put himself on the cliff accidentally. Era? Is that... that's the dire side award, so he doesn't know.
No, he does not. But still, all the same, of the heroes that they killed, the one of the two that Vega really didn't want to die there was the Ancient Apparition. They've got the troll with the most net worth, and they got the AA with the big pickup. He was one Midas transmute away from a Aghanim Scepter, and at that point, like, he can just sit in Fountain and nuke across the map for all he cares. Like, he can actually just do, probably make his highest impact using that strategy until he gets the BOTs anyways. But in this case, he goes down at the tail end of it. They get the tier 3, but they get weather the storm. Now they have Black Hole. Now they actually can avoid just that split push play and actually go for an actual offensive one.
Yeah, they've got Scotty up very soon on the Slark as well. Obviously, he needs to consider holding on to buyback, but you know that stat item is so big. Ah, another one miss. No one gets picked off here in the top rune area.
It just goes in and tries to go for the rune around the corner when he has no vision, and they stun him 3 times and he dies. They do commit Death Ward Maledict, but otherwise, nothing really fancy.
All right, 8 to 13, 26 minutes in. It's still a lead for Vega Squadron, but it hasn't really been grown, despite the fact that they got some early towers. Oh, pick off on Hanskin. He tried to go for the counter ward play, but he's not going to be able to do much about this one. Era thinks about going for the kill on a solo. Limp even TP'd in for that one with Boots of Travel. He's going to try and make the dive here, but decides against it. Starts backing up. The rest of his team is in this bottom lane, so there is the potential that they could turn. Pasha's coming in from the left-hand side. We'll see the Witch Doctor Illusion. Tries to go for it first. Seal Kid leads him down with the stun. I'm not sure if they're trying to buy space. Yonos Afan has the opportunity to go for a black hole. Needs to be able to jump now. Goes, locks down Mag as best possible. Now he's been silenced up. Era fights up against Pasha, but that's not a fight he can win. Mag will be taken out. So far, one for one. Relocate forward here. They're going to try and get solo. They add in that extra bit of movement speed. Oh, what an RP! They're turning off the ice blast, and that's going to be a wipe here! Era trying to get away, pounces to distance, but the ranged attacks are going to be enough, and no one. That was a back and forth where it looked like Vega Squadron might have stumbled into a black hole, but instead it's NiP who stumble into the RP of no one. Nicely played, and that's going to be NiP wiped and probably losing their first lane of Rax.
Absolutely incredible there. The RP was perfect, and they were ready for it, too. You can see the Ancient Apparition was so far across the map. Already Ice Blast was in play. They knew that they were going to chase to that position. The trap was set, and even Zeus's Suicide doesn't do any healing with that Ice Blast hitting on everyone. It was just absolutely perfect. With communication between Sioma and no one, they knew exactly where they were going to be able to bait them in, and that was planned out 5-8 seconds in advance. That was really smooth from them. They wipe out the mid-racks, and they take a really good foothold in this game. It's going to be so difficult for NiP to bring it back, even though they're finding farm.
BKB now picked up for the Magnus. What other items do we have? The Troll, who's got a full-out Scotty, plus another 2,400 gold on top of that. And Era, while he was trying to work towards the Scotty, is now left with that odd predicament of the amount of farm he gets before Vega Squadron go for another push is probably only going to be enough to either finish this Scotty or have buyback. And neither one is
check
really
out the board.
A great commitment.
Solo sees the two ultimate orbs in Slark's inventory. He's like, okay, well, let's just keep that secret shop covered. By killing this tier 2 and putting this observer ward up, they can delay that Scotty 3 more minutes by killing the courier.
Nice. They only option, I guess, for Era now is to go ahead and fly the courier out to the dire side, but that's highly unlikely. He's probably going to stumble into this trap that Vega Squadron have set up. So continuing to farm out, we've got a 3-man smoke gank push forward, but in top lane, they're going to be able to grab Era, pull him back into his doom as Hanskin is unable to get off the relocate in time. Looks like he got bumped and will end up losing that relocate out. And no buyback out from the Slark. I said he's going to have to have a choice to be made. Well, turns out he doesn't even have enough for that. You know, Safan coming in from behind is actually going to go for the Ancient Apparition. Not sure what his setup is here, but he will fall. And that is going to be, I think, NiP making some sort of weird YOLO plays where they know this game is pretty much over. They lose the Zeus. GG, well played. Game number 2 goes to Vegas. They tie up the score with Ninjas in Pajamas.
Yeah, that Era pickoff was too much, and everybody else just, they wanted to be a part of it. You know, they're involved. They're a team. They win together and they lose together, and NiP, they're going to have to try to work on the former, because this game was so chaotic, so scattered. This was and not necessarily like CISD in an aggression, but so much so in the fact that it really warps your brain as far as where things are in the game. It's not standard Dota. It's shifting lanes constantly, and it's continuous wins for Vega Squadron. They were able to take so many towers, take so many opportunities, and it's because the lanes played out the way they did.
All right, guys, so we're going to a game number three here in this best of three between Vega Squadron and Ninjas in Pajamas in the winner's bracket of the Join Dota MLG Pro League Season number 2. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.